Morning, sir.
Please take your seat.
Thank you, sir.
Mrithinjai, will you briefly introduce yourself?
My name is Mrithinjai. I was born in Chennai, but I had the opportunity to grow up in Chennai, Mumbai, and Delhi. My father was working with a PSU, so it was a transferable job. I have an elder brother who's working in the US, and right after studies, I took up a BA honors in economics, a three-year course, and after completing that, I joined into the Indian Revenue Service, Customs and GST. And here again, I got the opportunity to be part of the service when we were implementing the GST.
Okay, very nice. You have a long list of hobbies.
Yes, sir. What has happened is, since I was shifting around, one thing which my parents taught me and which I learned is whatever opportunity that I get, I should take it up to learn something new. And that itself became a hobby. So when I was in Mumbai, I got the chance to do roller skating and take up calligraphy. Then in Delhi, the opportunity for tennis came up, and even Chinese language. So that's how it's come, sir.
Learning Veda chanting and understanding its meaning.
Yes, sir.
What is it?
So when I was, one thing is that Veda chanting runs in the family from my grandfather and parents. And at the age of around 7 or 8, my grandfather gave me this shloka, the Gayatri Mantra. He talked about it in the Ganapata, that is, the first sentence is Tatsa Vitur Varenyam Bhargo Devas Siddhi Mahi. That he showed me that it could be chanted in 5 different ways. Something like, if there are 4 words, 1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1. And what struck me was the manner in which something which is more than 3,000 years old has carried on without any written form, just the oral tradition. And the manner in which it is still preserved, that is something which struck me. And that's how I started Veda chanting. And as I started chanting and as I grew up, I came across Vedic mathematics and concepts like that, where there are scientific, things which are mentioned in the Vedas. That got me interested into understanding the meaning of what I've been chanting, and that's how it started, sir.
Bhadram karne bhi suniyam adeva. What does it mean?
May my ears hear all good things. Karne bhi suniyam adeva. Bhadram is good. Karne bhi is my ears. May my ears hear good things.
Purnam idam purnamadaya. Purnam eva vasishyate. What does it mean?
It talks about completeness. May people reach completeness in the sense the heights of excellence. Purnasya purnamadaya purnameva vashishyate. It's a prayer that things should reach their completion and people strive for completeness and excellence.
So, what is the basic features of all the 4 Vedas? Rug Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda and Atharva Veda.
So if you look at the text of it, it is said that the Rig Veda consists of hymns in praise of the Lord. The Yajur Veda deals with the rituals. The Sama Veda is a musical form of the Rig Veda. And the Atharva Veda includes day-to-day practices and rituals as well. This is the basic differences. But a lot of shlokas in the Rig Veda find their place in the Sama Veda as well. And the basic philosophy is about God and also has some scientific rituals in it, sir.
Okay. Have you read today's newspaper?
Yes, sir. The Hindu newspaper.
Achha. What about the Kaveri water dispute? What has come out today?
Sir, there was a meeting chaired by the Secretary for Union Water Resources to discuss about the setting up of a Kaveri Water Management Board. And the Supreme Court directions, the judgment, had said that within 6 weeks, a management board has to be set up to ensure that there is proper sharing of waters. And there has been a delay in that, and the news today was with regards to that, where Tamil Nadu state has put up the proposal that...
Does the Supreme Court judgment say that Kaveri Management Board is to be formed?
So it was
that
a part
was the issue.
It was a part of the dispute, the tribunal judgment, and the Supreme Court judgment talked about that...
About a scheme. A scheme has to be done within 6 weeks.
Yes, sir. But it doesn't change, it doesn't make any mention or doesn't make any changes to the tribunal's judgment with regards to the management board. And I think the fundamental issue of dispute between all the states was distress sharing of waters when the monsoon fails. And that again is the responsibility of the Kaveri Management Board.
But so this thing has been pointed out by Karnataka government, okay. Karnataka, why does it not want that there should be a Kaveri Management Board?
So the main issue which the coverage management board seeks to remove the individual state's authority or autonomy over regulating the water flow, and the Kaveri management board will take over the ownership of all the dams through the Kaveri river and will regulate how much water has to be released. Presently it is done by the individual state governments, but the scheme envisaged is that the Kaveri management board will take that up, and
so
that is something.
So how do you suggest the dispute is to resolve?
I feel that there is the Supreme Court's the fundamental principle of its judgment is that interstate rivers are national assets, and a state cannot have claim over the territorial water. So to that extent, states having control over the dams which are in its territory would go against the basic principle of the Supreme Court judgment. So to that extent, it is required that we have a Kaveri Management Board. It has to be constituted, sir. But we can ensure that all the members of the different states are part of it, and the decisions which it takes is transparent, like how the Monetary Policy Committee comes out with its minutes, the same manner a transparent CMB would.
Yes, whenever there is a dispute on river waters, generally a management board has to be there. Like Indus Water Commission is there, in which both India and Pakistan have their members,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So it has to be an independent authority, apart from the states. Okay, thank you.
You have done economics and you have taken economics for
options.
Can you explain what is strong ordering and weak ordering?
With regards to microeconomics, there is this preference set where strong ordering of preferences against a weak ordering of preference. So a strong ordering would mean that, let's say there are two choices, A, B, and C, three choices. So a strong ordering of preference of A over B and B over C would mean that in all cases, the preference set A will be preferred over B and C, whereas in a weak ordering, the preference set is not as strong in the sense A would be preferred over B or equally preferred. So that equality aspect comes in. This is my.
So the way you have listed your ranking of different services,
yes, sir.
Is it strong ordering or weak ordering?
It's a strong ordering. I opted for just one service.
Just one. What is the rationale
behind it? I've been working in the revenue services. And for me, it's not about a job in that sense. What I was looking at is a variety of work, because the work where I am right now is about just revenue collection. And something which motivates me is the fact that in the IAS, I get to do not just revenue collection, but also working for public spending, welfare, and at a later level, even policy formulation. And that is something which excites me and which has made me come here for.
Do you think that a very professional decision making is not there in other services?
I feel that the IAS has the variety of opportunities which is there in the IAS is unrivaled compared to the other services. That was my logic for this.
When you say not opted, well, what does it mean? Are you running down the other courses?
No, sir. I am presently in a job. So to that extent, I feel that every service has a role to play in our country, and it's all a civil service ultimately. But if I look at when I'm comparing the other services vis-a-vis my own service, the revenue service, I feel that the opportunity and the variety, what excites me, is there in the administrative services. That's the reason.
In our fiscal system, where do you think the growth rate is higher, the direct taxes or indirect taxes?
So the direct taxes, traditionally, as per the traditional economic model, as the country grows, direct taxes would continue to play a major role.
What is happening now?
The past couple of years, we've noticed that indirect taxes have also gone up a little bit more, and this is mainly because of excise duty on petroleum, where while the global crude oil prices declined, the government continued to have a high rate of excise duty, which led to a spurt in indirect taxes. And added to that is the GST, which is coming up. So
why does the GST regime exclude the petroleum?
So there. Theoretically, a goods and services tax should include all the products in the supply chain. But in the case of petroleum, it's a special case because it contributes revenue to the state governments as well. While center has the direct taxes to collect its revenue from, states do not have that leeway. They only have to rely on petroleum and alcohol for human consumption. That's the reason for keeping it out.
Revenue neutrality provision in the GST Act.
Yes, sir.
So why can't this be included in the GST?
There are proposals for inclusion of, because if we look at it, constitutionally, petroleum and petroleum products are included as a taxable supply under GST, But it has been said that at a later date, the GST Council, with the consensus of all states, will take a call. And we are moving towards that consensus. Once that comes, it will be, the supply chain will be smooth, sir.
When does a tax become a buoyant tax, and how do you measure it?
Sir, buoyancy is a concept where we look at the improvements in tax revenue, the percentage change in tax revenue as a proportion of percentage change in the growth rate of the economy, the GDP growth. So if there is a growth in, let's say, a percentage growth in GDP, which leads to a more than 1% increase in the tax rate, in the tax collection, sorry, that means it's a buoyant tax, where the tax mechanism which we have is better able to capture the growth and gain revenues for the government.
In India, what are the factors that contribute to tax evasion?
If I look at it, I'm reminded of Adam Smith's canons of taxation. The first issue with which is a problem in India is that there's the complexity of taxes, where the varied provisions makes it easy for people to avoid taxes, and at the same time, people who are genuine and want to pay the taxes, they are not able to understand the provisions. That is the first. Second is the cost of compliance going high, where if I have to pay, let's say if I have to file my GST return, in the first month it took me almost half a day to one day to just file my return. So that forms as an disincentive to carry out the compliance process. And thirdly, it also depends on the status of our economy, where the informal sector dominates the formal sector. So to that extent, we have a very less percentage of population paying the taxes, whereas a large percentage is out of the tax net.
Do you think the fiscal deficit should be at 5%? Should it be, is it a normative thing that fiscal deficit should be at 5%?
Sir, our targets are a 3% target, 3 to 3.5%. And it's with the logic that if government spending goes out of hand, what happens is, on the one hand, there is a threat of inflation, and secondly, government spending is from borrowing in the domestic market, and this tends to crowd out investments by the small MSME sector. So they find it difficult to access funds.
The fiscal deficit level of the central government is different from the fiscal deficit levels of the state government.
Yes, sir.
And how do you find this situation? Does it contribute to fiscal discipline in the overall context?
Again, here to answer this question, we'll have to go back to the FRBM Act, which was the basic guideline which we had brought in for fiscal discipline, and there we noticed that bringing in fiscal discipline in the state governments was an easier task because a lot of the spending with regards to development related works was coming out of the central funds. So to that extent, states were able to manage the revenue expenditure component better.
Okay.
Yeah,
you have mentioned that you are best in firing at weapons training course of IRS training.
Yes, sir.
Did that interest you to join IGS?
Sir, the aspect about weapons training which I loved was the fact that it involved a concentration over the mind and the body, because a lot of the long-range weapons which we used was about having your body movements under control. But for me, IPS was something which I didn't prefer, because I wanted to do a more... My motivation from the beginning was IAS, so to that extent it was didn't enter as much.
Right. Nowadays, you find not many people from arts background getting into the civil service. Fortunately, you are one of the arts graduates. You have done your commerce.
BA honors in economics. Sir.
Why is it that people from arts background get into civil services?
So one aspect is the statistical thing, that the number of people who take up arts courses vis-a-vis the number of people who do engineering in our country. The numbers are skewed in favor of engineering. So if we look at a percentage, automatically, one aspect is we will tend to have a lot many more engineers coming in to the civil services. That is one aspect. But having said that, in recent years, the nature of the exam pattern has also been changed. So a lot of people say that the CSAT paper, which was there, that favored a lot of, that was in favor of people who had done engineering background.
What about your personal opinion?
My personal opinion, sir, I feel it's both courses will equally equip you to carry out whatever qualities which are needed in the IAS. Ultimately, an IAS officer should be one who can manage people around them, and the subject knowledge is something which everybody can pick up. It just needs that aptitude and the ability to manage people and and manage situations. So to that extent, the education background doesn't matter much, is my answer.
Your hometown is Chennai, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Why is that you have a lot of opposition for Vedic learning in Tamil Nadu? What are the basic issues here?
Sir, if you look at it, more than Vedic learning, the opposition is towards what has happened is Vedic learning tends to be associated with Brahmanism and caste oppression, because Tamil Nadu had the history of the Periyar justice movement of Dr. Periyar. And what happened is the society moved towards a casteless system where people had reduced, dropped their surnames and things like that, where caste-based overt expression of caste identities was removed. So what has happened is the opposition is towards caste-based oppression, and it is noticed that Vedic chanting, it is felt, it is a caste-based occupation. So people from the Brahmin caste are the ones who have access to the Vedas, and hence it became a symbol of opposition. That is the reason, sir.
But isn't it true that the Brahmins are the ones who chant the Vedas?
Sir, I feel that the opportunity for learning the Vedas is available for every caste group, because if we go back to the original system, how it was there in the earlier period, the chanting of Vedas was open to men, women, and the other caste persons as well. It was more of an occupational based varna system rather than a rigid caste hierarchy. But sad fact is it has degenerated into a birth based system where a son or the child of a Brahmin becomes a Brahmin. So to that extent, it had degenerated to that, but the original idea is that it is open for anybody who is willing to learn. Sir, if we look at the country situation as a whole, I feel that Tamil Nadu's situation with regards to caste violence had improved substantially compared to the other states. But having said that, there is also the concept of Sanskritization, which the anthropologist, sociologist Srinivas had given, where what happens is the people, the existing caste hierarchies continues to dominate, and the mid-level, I mean, just to give, to explain, I'm just talking about a hierarchy with although I don't subscribe to that, but the fact is the castes who consider themselves as a dominant or mid-level caste want to continue their the dominance over the so-called Dalits or the oppressed classes. And when the economic system leads to equal growth of all sections of the society, they tend to oppose it by reinforcing the caste identity and caste superiority. That's the reason for the presence of caste clashes in the country. But I feel that the situation in Tamil Nadu, because of the Periyarist movement, was much better as compared to the others. Because if you look at the education achievements of Tamil Nadu, the health, the role of women, all these three are much better because of the justice movement started by the Dravidian parties.
Well, let me begin with the economics. Well, for a long time, the classical economics was dominated by what is called the utilitarian tradition. Can you tell me something about that?
Sir, the utilitarian tradition was with regards to the fundamentals of economics was how to measure an individual's improvement, material improvement, or because of a particular policy or an economic change. So the utilitarian movement measured, tried to express this in terms of people's benefits. The concept of utility is the benefits that I gain from a particular change. So if we analyze prices and tax measure, then the utility gained by the person was a judging criteria. So let us say a tax was introduced or the price of a commodity had changed, then the utility change was measured, and based on that the prices would come out. It was the Alfred Marshall concept of utility which was prevalent in the early times.
So you would not include the father of economics in the utilitarian tradition?
Alfred Marshall, his focus was on wealth, and of course he started the aspect, but I feel the work of the subsequent theorists focused more on the distribution aspect, and that is where the utility theory was more.
Okay, so you would associate the Indo-European tradition only with Alfred Marshall?
No, sir, even Walrasian Marshall, Adam Smith, of course, was the Wealth of Nations, and he talked about the wealth theory. But Marshall and Walras were focused on distributional aspects. That's why utility played a major role. Sir.
Classical economics were also had a discourse on welfarism against development, right? And so, what is the present state of that debate, the traditional dichotomy between welfare and development?
Sir, I think we generally tend to talk about there being a strict separation as growth and distribution, but the actual difference is more nuanced in the sense it's a debate about what is to be given more priority over, whether we focus on growth or we focus on first redistribution to facilitate growth. It's like saying that the growth theory talks about, the people who support the emphasis on growth, it's about how a cake has to be increased, the size of the cake has to be increased before sharing it. So to increase the size of the cake, growth is the major factor which drives that. Whereas the distribution, the theorists who focus more on distribution aspect feel that redistributing the existing resources, particularly areas like education and health, will drive the growth further, and that will lead to a more equitable society. So that's the dichotomy. It's about where we emphasize, and I feel that the recent development in this field is that all theorists recognize the role of education as an important factor. So a distribution or a growth where education or human capital is focused upon rather than finance capital, that would work.
So how would you locate Amartya Sen into this debate on welfare versus development?
So Professor Amartya Sen's views were more with regards to the development or the welfare aspect about distribution. His theory of freedoms, which talks about expanding the people's freedoms, will automatically lead to a growth and...
What's the name of his book? In this debate...
Yes, sir.
He had a book, na?
Yes, sir. He had co-authored it with John Dress.
Yes.
It's about...
That's okay, please.
It had come in 2016.
Yes, two years back.
2 years back.
Argumentative Indian. You heard about it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can you tell me something about this book, at least the substance of it, Asian drama.
Sorry, I haven't...
Gunnar Myrdal.
Okay. Gunnar Myrdal.
We got Nobel Prize.
Yes, sir. So Myrdal's theory was about...
Asian drama.
Huh?
It's about... my question pertains to Asian drama as such.
Sir, I haven't come across this.
Okay. One of your hobbies is to interact with the people to understand their culture. Now, people say that Tamilians are more ethnocentric, jingoistic, rather than people of other states. Now, you are actually a Hindi-speaking person, but who was born and brought up in Tamil Nadu. What do you have to say to this?
Sir, if you look at one of the reasons is that Tamil Nadu has a rich cultural heritage, which has carried forward and has not been, has not changed over the years. It has modified and it has updated with the changing times, but the essence of it has carried on. And I think if we look at the entire history of the world, apart from the Chinese and the Chinese civilization and Iran, India's civilization, the Sanskritic traditions and Tamil traditions are the only cultures which have lived on for almost 3,000 years. So to that extent, there is a rich cultural heritage, and identifying and having that as the element of people of Tamil Nadu in the recent years, it cannot be ignored. That is one aspect. Having said that, I recently came across an article by a person from Madhya Pradesh who had settled in Chennai. There, it gives an interesting insight that the people of Tamil Nadu continue to accept outsiders. So it is not that they are more jingoistic and harp on to their own traditions. People of Tamil Nadu continue to accept, and they make an attempt to reach out to people from the other states as well. So to that extent, if you look at the data, the maximum number of people who moved out of Tamil Nadu and served across the country and in the other parts of the world are Tamilians. So to say that they are jingoistic and they are culturally very close would not be correct.
It's not a close culture. You say it is open.
There are people of Tamil Nadu, while as a Tamilian, what I can say is while I respect the cultures of others and I'm open to it, at the same time I also hold on to my identity. That's the
It is whose statement?
Which one?
You are quoting somebody's statement.
No, sir. It's mine.
You are quoting.
Your own answer.
Whose statement is that? Whose Prime Minister quoted at Davos?
Oh.
It's a Gandhi statement.
Okay, sir.
It's a Gandhi statement. I will be in my house, so let all wind from all directions come through it. Okay. But I will not be blown off my feet.
Right.
You should know that. Our Prime Minister also quoted at Davos. Okay.
Right. Moving on to politics.
Yes, sir.
Right. So, see, now recent election shown in Northeast, BJP had only few seats, but they could able to make, come back to power, not coming to power. The other party, apparent party, the largest number of seats, earned by Congress. Okay, how do you see this scenario? Now, when you are in power, you can purchase anything.
If you're referring to the Meghalaya...
Not only Meghalaya, in all seats, even Meghalaya, even all three states.
But, sir, in Meghalaya and Nagaland, to be specific, I think before the elections, the governments had a pre-poll alliance that they were all part of the Northeast Democratic Association,
okay,
where one of the common, let's say, enemies, political enemy, was the Congress Party. So to that extent, if the alliance, after the results came out, had the largest number of seats, they were able to form a government. And traditionally, if you look at it, there is a theory that psychologically, the regional party will want to ally with the party which
party
is in power at the center.
Okay.
That is a psychological thing where you would want more resources for your state's development. And
so you get more from your big brother.
Yes, sir. From the party which is in the center. Right?
Center. That's what is the big brother. There is east in Delhi. So that's what.
This has been the case with regardless of BJP or Congress.
Okay.
That has been the issue throughout our history, sir.
Okay. In the NDA constituents now, Telugu Desam is moving out and saying that the Andhra Pradesh should be given the special status. Now, Finance Minister told that we will give a package, not a special status.
Yes.
How do you see the difference of special status and the package?
Sir, of course, the Telugu Desam Party had withdrawn from the government, but they still are part of the NDA. But the main issue was at the in the Rajya Sabha, when the split of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh had come up, there was an assurance about giving special status. Fundamental benefit of being a special status state, special category state, is that when it comes to development funding, the center will share 90%. The breakup would be 90:10, whereas it's in a normal state, 60:40. But the reason why our finance minister says he's not able to give that is this law was passed in 2014, but from 2015 to 20, we had the 14th Finance Commission, which specifically made a statement that special category status should be restricted only to the northeastern states and the three hilly states. So constitutionally, our finance minister is not in a position to carry out a measure where we give special status. But what he's promised is that the finance aspect, that is the amount financial benefit which would have accrued to Andhra Pradesh, will be compensated. And he has said that we'll have a mechanism through a special purpose vehicle to ensure that fiscal deficit is not affected, because again, central and state governments have targets for bringing the deficits under control. This was the issue, sir.
I think. Okay. Now, when you lived in Chennai, Mumbai, and Delhi,
yes,
and then you studied in Stevens.
Sriram College. Yes.
Sriram College of Commerce, right? Now you have seen three metros.
Yes, sir.
And the MRTS, mass transit system, that it's like all the states now, all the metros we have. Now, one swift action that we have to take it in Delhi, we had to take it in, since from 2000, it's about metro, right? But even having started metro, still the congestion or pollution did not come down. What could be the reason? Because you lived in Delhi, but it is not the case in Mumbai or in Chennai.
First aspect is with regards to the geographic location, because Delhi, by virtue of being inside a continentality factor, means that the atmosphere, whatever pollutants are there, they're not cleared faster. Whereas Mumbai and Chennai, by virtue of being a coastal city, has that benefit.
Very good.
Secondly, we also see that the rate of growth of Delhi has been the fastest, not just in our country, but the world over. And the nature of growth of Delhi has been, we have 6-lane roads in the middle of the city. So that automatically encourages people to buy more cars. So a household in Delhi will have, on an average, 2 cars. That is the...
Okay.
Okay. Now, coming to some here.
Purnamidam Purnamada Purnameva Vasishyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnat Purnamudachyate, first one. It is a description of the Brahman. If you take nothing from it, it is always full. Purnamidam Purnam Idam, it is always full. Purnam Purnam Purnat Purnamudachyate. Even if you take full, it is still full. If you take a small amount from it, it is also full. Purnasya Purnamadaya. If you take the full out of the full, it is still full. Purnameva Vasishyate. So, Purna is still the remaining. Okay, the description of the Brahman. Okay, second, so coming to the fiscal deficit, this 3%, there is nothing very sacrosanct about it. Where from 3% comes? It's from EU.
EU, yes.
European Union's prescription that it has to have around 3% and no death penalty, all those provisions are there. Okay, now there is an FRBM committee under NK Singh. You are aware of these recommendations?
Sir.
What are the recommendations?
It talked about a movement from a fiscal deficit target to a debt target where we
No. Debt target is separate. 40% for center and 20% for state, 60% total. That is a different thing. On fiscal deficit, what does it say?
It called for having a fiscal management committee approach where...
It says it should be a band, not a fixed term, not a fixed number like 3%. Okay. A band like the inflation band.
Yes, sir.
4 to...
Yes.
4... plus minus 2.
Yes.
So either 2 or 6. So it talks of exactly don't give 3%, make it a band.
Yes.
Okay, that's a major recommendation. So there's nothing. Around 3 months back, there was a very brilliant article on this fiscal deficit in Economic Times. It relates these fiscal deficit norms to the capital formation, gross fixed capital formation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In India case, it is much less, now 26-27%. It has come down in 2007-2008. It was the highest, 37%.
Yes,
37, around 10% it has been reduced.
Yes, sir.
So it says that in other developed countries, it is much more. So we need not have it at 3%. The article was simply brilliant. If I can tell you later on the date on which the article came,
I remember coming across this.
Yes, it had come. It was a beautiful analysis of the fiscal deficit as to why it is nothing sacrosanct about this 3%. And we just cannot blindly follow what EU, because EU is all, everything is developed.
Yes.
Okay, take it.
I think your technical information is out there, and especially in the areas related to tax and policy, and we've got to be very more additions like that. You have to add, and you cushion your answer with the other information, because there are certain indicators which we get it from the conditionality clause of the IMF. But in our system, it's very difficult to because we have a lot of designated expenditures or government expenditures which have to be honored. So we can't restrict them using this status. Then I think you must have an answer for saying not opted for other services. Some convincing answer, not that strong or the kind of thing. The economists will understand it, but the panel is not. You are able to give answers, but you are very swift and probably you are very categorical. That's maybe you have to tone down. Of that rapid fire, you tend to be categorical. So, try to, because nothing can be categorically said. There's always another dimension as well. So, then try to tone down your answers. And also, the rapid response you try to control. So, I'm not asking you to slow down completely, but that rapidly reacting, even without a buffer time, you are reacting. That can be taken care of.
I've written lots about your interest area of public policy. You are sure about the Chinese and the Vedic chanting, diverse fields. So probably, you know, what is similarities between the Chinese language and Vedic chanting or all the things, just to get to know all the things.
calling Vedic chanting. Suppose somebody puts a
UNESCO heritage. Is it a UNESCO heritage?
Sorry, sir?
UNESCO intangible heritage it has got?
Yes, sir.
So they may ask.
Vedic chanting, suppose somebody wants you to put in a spot. Recently, one union minister said South Indians only chant better, North Indians don't do it. Suppose questions of that kind is asked to you, but be prepared for an answer. Right. That minister is known for his controversial statements, but one of the statements he has given is this.
Hey, what is sudden interest in Vedic chanting, or you know, issues with regard to Veda, cosmic, quite off late, while for the last 3-4 years, all of a sudden. It has got a political vote on it.
Yes.
They may think of the IIT issue. Because the prayer was said.
Yes.
And immediately there's a big. So now you are living in a particular state where things are not in tune with the mainstream. So the panel may ask you some questions to know why does it happen.
Controversial statements like evolution is not correct. Education minister. And he also said that I am an MSc in chemistry. I am not an art student. That is what he said the next day. Next day said, I am not an art student. I am an MSc in chemistry. Okay.
I think when you discuss about utilitarian tradition, usually the discussion stems from the basic concept of rationality. In fact, the whole idea of utilitarianism is associated with British economics, okay, British economist, okay, and how Amartya Sen was trying to break the traditional dichotomy between welfareism and development. I think that is that you need to expose, okay, and in fact, my earlier question was actually a leading question and led to Amartya Sen. So I thought this would figure into our discussion, but it did not. Okay. Yeah, fine.
I will later tell you the name of Amartya Sen's book. There are two books, Amartya Sen and Bhagavati on the other side. So I will tell you the name of the books. Yes. Two books are there.
I remember it was reviewed. Okay. There was a book review in the Economist magazine which led to the whole
latest one book has come. In January, the review came.
Okay,
Education, the Wealth of the Nation.
The Real Wealth of Nations by Surjit Bhallar.
Since you have discussed, read that.
Yes, sir. Right.
In January.
Yes, sir. So the Real Wealth of Nations is the name
of the
book.
Yes.
Book.
Indian.
No, you're wrong. The observation valid, and then it was a correct reason, that is the thing. One thing I expected, this giving a special status, and it's all politics, right? And the central government status, and in the VA, minister told, and he told it's right. So then, other than that, about sitting, comparing about the state and the cities, it was perfect because the 50% of our pollutant get really attracted towards, like you, it goes to the sea, right? There is a system in the science also. So that's a little bit neat. Otherwise, it's also very dirty. But there is no other way that in Delhi pollution gets really substituted. That was the reason. Okay, understanding, and then overall, I found, but the thing is that you are there for service and revenue, custom. See, GST, you must be now thorough. Nobody will ask about GST. They will really know some other areas where you have to be very strong, especially in economics. Economics is something I wanted to really ask the shift from before pre-91 and post-91. I did not ask the question. Because I found after giving the answer, I found your economics also you are strong. So better I drop your question. Right? So overall, you are giving very good answer, but expectation will be very high because of your seniority in working in the government for the last.
So economics, so you are walking into a lion's den, Delhi. So be prepared for complicated economic questions on the applied side. Both theoretical you are able to explain, but applied side you must be able to. You must be prepared because some professor from Delhi will be.
Instead of economic growth.
Sir, he will be able to do. Sriram, I know, because Delhi, I was there.
What is the basic theory in that book, Education, the Wealth of Nations?
So he talked about it where he opposed the common theories that there is a growing inequality in the world. He said that finance capital inequality is there, but if we look at it in terms of education, we find that the differences between the countries are converging. And
to be clear, where there is more education, there is more income there.
And there is more possibility of future incomes. That was his
That's the basic of that theory. If an educated community has greater income.
But whatever the way it may go, but be ready, I think you will answer every question you ask. But your experience is there. But expectation will be very high, that's what I mean.
Yeah, expectation is high. Very your
high.
Achievement will also be high.
Yeah.
So
but
I
if
want
really
to see your name somewhere at the
very
top.
Very good. What sir says, it's like, if you really fulfill that aspiration, that question, you also get very good marks.
Because at this stage, my target is to get the maximum marks because...
Yes,
first time you are taking an interview?
No, sir.
In the job,
sir, he is already in the civil service.
UPSC IAS interview, have you gone before? Or this
sir, the same exam.
Already service only.
Even
the service.
He is in IRS.
IRS.
But that is, years back.
Yeah. 6 years back.
2012 exam. 13 I took 13. The interview. Oh, 14 again I was there as part of.
Whatever is greater is not achieved easily, and whatever is achieved easily is not greater.
Yes.
Okay.
But you know Tamil?
Yes, sir. I am from...
No, no, it's okay. Yes,
see, you have lost some 5 years of senior, isn't it? Supposing you
4 years,
yes.
2018. Yes, sir.
Do you think that you will really make it to the top of the slot?
But sir, still he is only 27 years old.
If he continues in IAS, probably you will become a...
No, no, ultimately, I think 22 he passed the exam.
Yes,
that's highly
he has a fair chance of being the chairman.
Chairman, yes.
Of Central Board of Customs and DA. But in IAS, they will make up. So the secretaryship...
In terms of joint secretary, presently there is a disparity of almost 9 years between IRS and IAS.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, what motivates is the job factor.
Harp on that.
Yes,
keep harping on that. Say that even if I become the top man in IRS, it doesn't, but my basic intention is
this. Now he told that answer. It has come out. Because then he is into it, so he knows that.
Okay.
Overall, I found good.
Very nice.
Able to make it. It's not making it, sir, but he's saying he's to be top.
Yes,
I guess
okay.
I need to work
personally,
on it.
Personally, I think you should even give an IFS. Personally. It's up to you. Anyways.
But personal liking it.
But prepare yourself for all the...
No, because they are going to take a lot of IFS people now. Because IFS cadre is only 700-800. They are demanding to be 1600 because India is one of the lowest. Even Singapore has 700.
Yes.
So IFS cadre has to increase. Others, IAS is 6,000, revenue service, income tax is from around 5,000. So all are very big cadres.
Yes.
And so far, diplomacy is concerned, India needs a lot of more diplomats. Such a big country and having embassy almost everywhere. So this has taken a staggered manner, foreign service.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. When is your interview?
Sir, 20th of March, sir.
20th only?
The next Tuesday, sir.
Oh, okay.
All the best.
Okay. Thank you.